Good morning. My name is Wayne Johnson. I'm a veterinarian. I'm currently working in Beijing. I've been here in China for 15 of the past 24, 25 years. I'm a graduate of the University of Illinois. I've practiced veterinary medicine for about 40 years. I graduated from the University of Illinois in 1980, and I've worked on pig farms and with the swine business most of my life. We operate a diagnostic laboratory and swine consultation service in Beijing, and from there we service pigs all over China and in other places in Asia as well. Today my topic for you is the ASF China experience, lessons to be learned. I'm very pleased to be talking with you. I had studied about ASF quite a bit before this outbreak occurred in China, but I was still quite surprised whenever ASF broke out here. Classical swine fever was the number one problem we had here before the outbreak of African swine fever occurred. These are some slides of some sows that have, from here in China, that had died from African swine fever. I'll not be talking very much about the pathobiology of ASF today. Some others will bring that to you. But I'm just showing you these slides to let you know that ASF is still occurring in China. We are still continuing to have outbreaks of the disease. This is the disease in some growing and finishing pigs with the very poor acute form. A lot of people like to talk about the spleen and the pathobiology that occurs in the spleen, but I think the thing that is the most striking about ASF, among other things, is the perirenal edema that occurs. We don't have any other diseases in China that I'm aware of that produce perirenal edema. This is a recent outbreak that occurred in Beijing on the 30th of December of 2019, just to let you know that the disease is still occurring here. The outbreaks of ASF are not generally reported anymore. This was diagnosed by the local authorities as atrophic rhinitis because the pigs were showing to have some bleeding at the nose. They told them that it was atrophic rhinitis and provided a negative test for ASF. We came out a day or two after that and opened some pigs and did some PCR and made a diagnosis of ASF. I suppose that the diagnosis of ASF surely could be made from just a very simple examination of these pictures. The virus moved from Russia to China apparently sometime during 2018, the best that we can tell. The apparently some sausages were brought in from Russia and through the matter of garbage feeding that these ended up into some pigs. Restaurant wastes and kitchen wastes were fed to pigs. And then the garbage feeders sold their pigs to slaughterhouses, and then they sold their pigs into the pig trade, and they went to pig farms. Some that were selling small pigs sold their pigs around to other farmers. And from there, the trucks carry the disease all over China and also to Vietnam. There are quite a few trucks going from Vietnam to China. A lot of trade of pigs across the border between Vietnam and China. The impact of ASF has been that about 25% of the world's pig population has died as a result of African swine fever. About half of the pigs in the world used to be in China, and now about half of those pigs have died. And it means we've lost about 25%, perhaps a little more than 25% of the world pig population. About 25% of the world sow population has also disappeared. And there has been massive financial loss of a of an incredible scale. And disruption of trade and the society in general, and various follow-on effects on agriculture and economy. What is it going to do to the grain trade next year whenever there's no pigs to feed? What is it going to do to the economy in general, the consumer price index, because everyone is spending more and more money for food than what they used to have to, and then what are the effects of agriculture? Because agriculture is basic in a society, and if you've got something going wrong with agriculture, then everything is going to be affected. There are many, many, many follow-on effects. The ASF impact on the pig industry. We've seen the destruction of the small pig farms. In Beijing, there were some 400 small pig farms at one time. Presently, there are 13, perhaps only 12 left now. In Beijing, we know of another one that has gone out. There's complete reorganization of the pig industry all over the country. There's been companies that have been bailed out by other companies. There's been mergers and acquisitions, and many of the small pig farms are out and have no way to get back into the pig business. There's been a reorganization of the feed industry in general, and there is slowly rebuilding, but there's a great deal of fear. There have been some failed restarts, and there is a lack of breeding animals. There's certainly a lack of quality breeding animals and a lack of gilts, period, that it doesn't even make very good economic sense if you do the calculations to keep back a gilt, if you consider that there's going to be any volatility in the market in the future. But indeed, people are starting back into the business, and it is not exactly easy, although pigs are bringing a tremendous price, and there is a lot of encouragement from the government for people to get back into the pig industry and back into the pig business. The methods by which ASF has spread, transboundary, in other words, from country to country, it's transmitted by trucks and by pigs, and of course by pork that via the garbage feeders ends up getting into pigs. And probably the pork is probably the main way that it's getting from country to country, but in some borders there are trucks and pigs that are crossing the border and getting moved for very, very long distances, and sometimes moved across the border in disguised buses and various other ways to get past the legal restraints on country to country movement. Inside the country, it's primarily moved by trucks and also moved by pigs that are infected, to some extent by people. It's possible that it could be moved by through the feed, and also by various fomites, various implements, things like this. Even fire trucks have been known to move the disease into a farm. Because it was on the highway in Shandong, we PCR'd it off the highway in Shandong, and a fire truck came into the farm, and a few days later the farm broke with ASF. On farm, it's primarily spread by boots and clothing. It can be spread by pigs, the tools that people are using, by feeds and feeding. Inside a building, it can be transmitted by aerosol, but it doesn't move very well by aerosol. Probably not even 20 or 30 meters will it move between buildings. Certainly, this is for sure true, and certainly other fomites can spread the disease. Things that people are moving, anything that's going from building to building, or from pen to pen, pig to pig. A direct contact is also very important. This kind of shows the history, how things happened in China, that first of all, we believe it came in with pork, and this pork, through garbage feeding, was fed to some pigs that died or became sick from ASF. They were moved by trucks to other pig farms, also moved by trucks to the slaughterhouse. Some of this pork from the slaughterhouse began to get back into the food chain and then fed back to other pigs. And so there was an increasing of the intensity of ASF along this cycle. In fact, we don't really know how long it occurred in this area before it finally became to the point that there was an outbreak that nobody could ignore anymore. Certainly, probably it was around before August of 2018, but nobody that I know knows for sure. But then from that point, we have ASF pigs going to the slaughterhouse. We have pigs coming back from the slaughterhouse that are carrying the ASF virus, and then they're moving it back and forth to other pigs. And then trucks become the big, big problem in the movement of ASF around China. And it's the way that it got moved around so fast. The trucks are not very well taken care of. They probably were clean when they were new. I had one fellow told me a few years ago that nobody was going to make him clean his truck. I suppose that real men don't clean their trucks, in his opinion. Why did ASF spread so quickly in China? One reason was because of garbage feeding. In the U.S., garbage feeding has been banned. It's been banned in Illinois for 20, 30 years. It's been illegal to feed garbage to pigs. It can spread many diseases of pigs and humans, trichinosis, toxoplasmosis, mad cow disease. CJD can be spread this way. Classical swine fever, ASF, some vesicular diseases all can be spread by garbage feeding. It is a bad idea, but there's a lot of garbage out there, and so it can find its way into some pigs, and there's no real laws in China to stop them from doing this. Inadequate biosecurity, dirty trucks, people that moving from farm to farm very freely, no real provisions for cleaning up trucks and no real desire to clean them up. We've made very serious threats long before ASF was a problem. We have had a lot of trouble with PED and PERS and a lot of other diseases simply because of these dirty trucks. I've stopped them personally. I've stopped the trucks and I've asked them why they didn't clean up the truck. I can tell you these are not very nice people, and but I wasn't very nice either. How did ASF spread so quickly in China? Continuing this relatively nonchalant, cavalier attitude about chronic disease in pigs. You know, so what if they've got disease? If we can make money, there's a lot of problems with CSF, PERS, PRV, foot and mouth disease, etc. China did have every disease except ASF, and now it has that also. There's the general acceptance of high mortality rates in sows and pigs. There's the mortality rate in some sow herds is approaching 10-15%. 10-20% in the nursery is not unusual, and even 20-40% in the growing and finishing is not an unusual thing. We've certainly seen that. Vaccination and antibiotic use is very prevalent. Very, very little concern about management in most Chinese pig farms, and rather poor production methods in general. There's a general lack of epidemiological information. There's non-reporting of cases. It is the law that the cases of ASF are supposed to be reported, but there are issues with some of the farms don't want to report, and some of the local bureaus don't want to report. There have been threats that if you would report this, we'll take you out of the pig business. A lack of an indemnity for the forced slaughter of pigs. Indeed, if you're going to have any kind of a cleanup program, you have to have some method for forcing the animals out of production. A lack of slaughterhouse monitoring. There is no trace back of pigs. There is the identity of pigs is completely lost. Nobody knows where they came from and where they're headed to. Lack of diagnostics. A great deal of cover up and secrecy. human consumption of dead pigs that people need. They need food. Consuming of the pigs that were actually had died from the disease was occurring through illegal marketing and various unwise practices. When you grind them up into sausage, you can't find the smell anymore. There's a great deal of willingness to engage in various kinds of theatrics, the spraying of cars and taxi cabs to make it seem as if we're really concerned about this disease, the installation of truck wheel baths, which is another kind of nonsense, a real lack of useful information. And where there's a lack of information, then people will start to make up information on their own. A lot of traditionalism, superstition, fake news, jokes and pranks and stuff of the of some very strange variety, some really strong misinformation. This is some of the spraying of the taxi cabs during the early stages of the disease in the south of Beijing. A spraying of pigs, they love to do this, they call this Xiaodu. They feel like that they're really getting something done by spraying disinfectant on these pigs. It's sort of absolute nonsense. The fogging of people, they make people stand in some of these fogging rooms, and this takes the place of having people take a shower. It's another sort of nonsense, and certainly quite harmful to the health of the people being subjected to these fogs. Bad advice and unwise recommendation. There was partitioning of the country followed by smuggling and corruption. The pigs were being hauled over the market all night down to Zhejiang because they didn't have any pigs, but their border was closed because they didn't have it for a while, the pigs went anyway. The forbidding of ASF testing, this is something that I believe is really just impossible to understand. They forbid people to test. Even the universities were forbidden to test for this disease for a while. And then there were these dreams. They still have these dreams of a ASF vaccine and a great deal of resources put after these. Presently, we have 7 different illegal vaccines that are in use in China, but none of them are of any use, and some of them are outright dangerous. I want to introduce the concept of VUCA. This is volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity. This really has characterized the situation that has occurred in this country since the outbreaks of classical swine fever. There's always a certain amount of volatility in the pig market. We have a hog cycle, which we all should be aware of. There's some uncertainty. We don't know what's going to happen in the future. Complexity is always, it's always a complex business. And then some ambiguity. We really don't know what the truth is sometimes, and that makes it very difficult for people to make decisions. Volatility. To overcome volatility, you have to move faster than your opponent. You have to know something about your opponent. You have to act faster than the viruses can act. You have to understand what are the characteristics of the virus. And you have to, if you can understand your enemy, you can move faster than him, and you can beat him at the game of volatility. This is the place where veterinarians come in. They have the training, they have the knowledge. They have the knowledge to beat the volatility that's associated with these diseases, where the veterinary community really needs to step up. Uncertainty. What others see as uncertainty, the real leaders in our society, they see those things as opportunity. Unfortunately, sometimes they see it as the opportunity to do something a little strange. But for the rest of us, we should see it as the opportunity to continue and to do good. There are not an infinite number of possibilities about what will happen. In fact, there's only a few possibilities about what is going to happen. And so the key to overcoming uncertainty is to have knowledge of the situation and to understand what the possibilities are. What is the best thing that could happen? What is the worst thing that could happen? What is the likely thing that's going to happen? We can start to plan ahead and we can deal with the uncertainty. Complexity. We can overcome complexity by resolving things into their component parts. And it's just a very, you know, you open up a computer, it's a very complex machine, but it's possible to understand that. Somebody put that together. So every difficult problem can be resolved into several parts, and we can deal with each part separately. To deal with a whole, it's perhaps too much for us. We can say that, you know, it's an old story, but anybody can eat an elephant. How do you eat an elephant? Just like eating a chicken, one bite at a time. We overcome complexity with the knowledge of the components. Sure, there's some work involved, but we can handle it. Ambiguity. This is the lack of verifiable and reliable information. Been a real problem in this Chinese ASF outbreak. We didn't have good data. We were forbidden to make diagnosis. We didn't have good analysis. We didn't have statistics. Mark Twain says there were liars and there were worse liars and then there were statisticians. Ambiguity is overcome by knowledge. We need good information and we need people who can understand it and figure it out. And this is the role of the veterinarian. It's a key role of the veterinarian. We want to be effective in what we do. You know, has the response to African swine fever been effective? Well, certainly our customers who have listened to what we have told them to do, they have not had problems with this disease, or at least very little, if they were able to follow the instructions clearly and do what we advise. They haven't had serious problems. Most of them have had no problems at all since the beginning of this disease. And certainly they've been under a great deal of pressure because it's everywhere and there are pigs going to the slaughterhouse with ASF every day. But what we need to do is to try to be effective. And this is a quote from John Boyd. John Boyd was a fighter pilot. Boyd said that an effective organization has an organizational climate for operational success. And some of the key factors in that, first of all, is unity, mutual trust among the players. I think that this was something that there has been a great deal of suspicion and mistrust that along this ASF outbreak. You should have intuitive competence. This is having a fingertip feel on what's going on. It takes a very special sort of competence. A mission orientation. We need to be focused on what we're doing and what's going to happen. The organization that have these four characters will be capable of outmaneuvering their opponents. And it's the internal simplicity of the organization that permits quick adaptability. That organizations that are weighed down by bureaucracy, they cannot react appropriately to a disease like African swine fever, that bureaucracy is the enemy of effectiveness. Now, Hamlet said, it wasn't Piglet, it was Hamlet. He said these words, and he said, at the time that something should have been done, nothing happened. And things went bad. And we lost the opportunity for action. And I think that is the, I suppose we could stop right there and say, this is what happened in China. the differential diagnosis is a very important thing. It's an important part of this knowledge, is knowing what the disease is. There have been a lot of pigs set to market that actually had classical swine fever, not ASF. These diseases look a lot alike. In fact, we've seen pigs with CSF and ASF. Pseudorabies, PRRS, erysipelas. We had one of our customers had an outbreak of erysipelas. They don't very often vaccinate for erysipelas here. They forget about this disease. We had some gilts that were not vaccinated, and they started to show some skin lesions and fever and went off feed, and we were quite concerned that it was ASF. Salmonellosis is not so common in China, but other places in the world it's common. PRDC, just a general respiratory disease in pigs. And of course, porcine circle virus, PCV2, PCV3 can look very, very much like ASF. Necropsy lesions that are suggestive of ASF, the perirenal edema I showed you, lesions in the heart muscle, blood or excessive bloody fluid in the thorax or abdomen, hemorrhagic lymph nodes, petechial and ecchymotic lesions in the kidney, enlarged friable spleen with lumpy areas. You won't see that all the time. Everybody, you know, talks about how big their spleens were. They have pictures on Facebook, but WeChat, holding the spleen up above their head and it touches the ground. Hemorrhages in the liver. Hemorrhages in the liver are uncommon unless there's been some sort of bodily trauma to a pig. And we can see massive hemorrhages in the livers of pigs that are sick or have died from ASF. Pneumonia with edema and meaty lung tissue, that's not very important, actually. There are lots of things that can cause pneumonia. However, pigs with ASF do have a very serious viral pneumonia. Hemorrhages in the kidney, PCV2, PCV3, sometimes pseudorabies, almost always CSF will cause some hemorrhages in the kidney. But not every pig that has died or sick with ASF will have kidney hemorrhages. Skin lesions, subcutaneous hemorrhages, and some of the lesions that are commonly associated with CSF, PCV, PRRS, or pseudorabies. Diagnosis is made by a nucleic acid test. Indeed, I think we can make the diagnosis in the field. There are signs of this disease that are very, very typical for ASF. But a PCR test is a confirmatory test. The LAMP test has been sort of neglected. The LAMP is a very cheap and efficient method for testing this disease. It is also extremely sensitive. It doesn't require any special equipment. It's very cheap. Certainly, I think it's a viable way to test for ASF. There is an approved LAMP kit available in China, but it's not popular. People like the technology of PCR. The universities are recommending PCR because most of them don't do LAMP. The test, if you send it to a laboratory, you can usually get the results back in 12 to 24 hours if you send it off to a lab. If you're doing LAMP yourself, you could get a positive LAMP in 15 minutes after you start the reaction. Of course, there's some preparation time involved in all of these things, and some transportation and whatnot. Blood, lungs, spleen, tonsil, these are kidney, these are all lymph node, these are all good tissues for ASF PCR. We like lung because lung is, if it turns out not to be ASF, we can test the lung for other diseases. We like to get a full set of tissues, just like we're going to be doing any other diagnosis work. We want to do histopathology. Necropsy animals, I know that some people have been advising against doing necropsy. I must say that's absolutely ridiculous. I can't imagine why you would want to tell people such a thing as to not get a diagnosis. We need a diagnosis. We need information. Necropsy should be done very, very carefully, and some surface that you can clean up. And if it looks like ASF, you're suspecting ASF, you should avoid contact with other pigs after the necropsy. Now, it's not like necropsy is going to bring you a disease that you don't have, but the thing with ASF is that we may be able to sequester the disease to some small part of the farm and get cleaned up quickly if we can get a quick diagnosis. So if you think it's, if you've opened a pig and you think it's ASF, it could be ASF, then you probably ought not see any other pigs for a couple of days and wait until you know for sure that by the lab test that it wasn't ASF, or if you know for sure that it's ASF, then you can start to act appropriately. Chronic ASF is a real concern, and it should be the ultimate sequel to vaccinations. One of the reasons that I am opposed to vaccine, we don't have any good vaccines available so far. There is some research going on. There are at least seven vaccines in the market in China, all of them sold illegally. But none of them are any real use, and some of them are quite dangerous. I think that insistence on a no vaccine policy may be the only way to prevent chronic ASF from becoming the norm in our pig farms and in our industries. Really not something that I want to see happen. If we've got a vaccination policy and living with this disease, it's going to continue to be a threat for the whole world. Disinfection. There's only really one disinfectant that I recommend. It's potassium peroxybonosulfate. One brand happens to be Vercon. There are some other disinfectants. If you listen to my other presentations, I will detail some of the disinfectants that could be used as a substitute for Vercon. There are substitutes. I think iodine and chlorine are very, very poor substitutes. They're not at all reliable for ASF control. I might use some chlorine if there was nothing else available. And alkaline agents are certainly it's a joke. It's not funny though, the virus will tolerate pH 13.4. That's 1% sodium hydroxide. It can stand that for up to 7 days if it's covered with serum. If it's not covered with serum, it could take as long as 21 hours for 1% sodium hydroxide to kill this virus. Cleaning is so important if we're dealing with no matter what disease we're dealing with for the pig industry. There's no substitute for sanitation and isolation. It's impossible to disinfect a dirty surface. And the biofilms that are produced by bacteria will coat the surfaces. You've got to get those off. An alkaline cleaner will help you to do a good job of cleaning. Very, very important that we do a good job of cleaning the surfaces. The way we arrange our pig production system is so important. I won't talk very much about biosecurity, but we need to have a local control area, a farm courtyard where the people get into. They shower to get into that area, and then another showering before they get into the area where the animals actually are. And we call this a 6-compartment system. The first decision is made at the local control area, whether you're going to get into the farm or not. You come into the dirty zone. You go through a shower, you change your shoes and your clothing. Now you're in the courtyard. This is where people eat. You take another shower to get into the pigs, which is the clean area of the farm. The high-risk items are what we need to be focusing on. People have wasted a lot of time focusing on things like vegetables and whether or not people eat pork outside the farm and such nonsense like this. Certainly, we don't want any outside pork coming into the farm. But the high-risk items are the feed bags, the dead animal trucks, the manure handling, and the pig hauling trucks. These are the things that we need to be taking care of and making sure that these things are dealt with. Feed could be a problem. The Chinese officials stated very early on that industrial feeds were a low risk. But we know for sure that there were some herds that there was a high probability that the virus came in through the feed. We observed how the feed was being contaminated, and it was believed that it's a problem. How might feed become contaminated? The use of contaminated feed ingredients. Some of the high-risk ingredients, some of the carriers that are used for various vitamins and ingredients could be a problem. I need to have some concern about what is being used as a carrier in these feeds. In China, it's been very common for feed ingredients to be cleaned on the highway, to be dried on the highway. It's really a bad idea. I haven't seen it occurring this year, but I suppose that in some areas of the country, they are still doing this. How might the feed become contaminated? Dirty trucks, dirty shoes and clothing, reused feed bags, dust in the feed mill, dirty hopper grates. All of these things could be a problem. We need to elevate the standard of what we do and make sure that things are clean. We need to have the same standard. I suppose that best management practices, good management practices, GMP level facility is probably what we need. That's what I want to see if I'm going to be buying feed. Pelleted feeds are good in this sense, and as much that the heating kills the virus. Certainly the virus is killed at 80 to 85 degrees centigrade for 3 minutes, but the feed could be contaminated in the mill. Excessive heating could damage some nutrients in the diet. Formaldehyde can be used as a feed mitigating agent, a risk mitigating agent. It will kill the virus after a period of time. It's not harmful to the pigs. It's been used in Europe for many years, but not used in China. What action should we take if we suspect ASF? First thing we should do is consider what is the goals of action. To minimize the economic loss, to conserve resources and valuable seed stock genetics, comply with the law, and prevent the disease from spreading to other farms. These are all seem to be worthwhile goals. The local disease control officials should be notified whether they want to know it or not. Management at the appropriate level, you need to tell the management the truth, not what you think they want to hear. What management should want to hear is the truth. You should notify any farms receiving animals that you suspect that you've got ASF, and notify your feed supplier. They deserve to know that you've got a problem. The quarantine, you can stop and hold shipments of any breeding animals and any semen until you know for sure that you're ASF negative. Stop the movement of piglets. Notify the farms receiving animals that you suspect ASF, but you haven't verified it yet. And then also notify your feed supplier. If ASF is strongly suspected or verified in the herd, we should remove all the animals in contact with the verified or suspected cases. Check the body temperature of any suspected cases. We can find out which animals need to be removed immediately. We can use separate clothing and footwear for the suspected buildings. And not foot baths. The foot baths are a waste of time. But if you're worried about people's feet, you have them change their boots and clothing. It is possible to salvage the ASF-infected farm. It's early detection of the disease, a confirmed diagnosis, nucleic acid test, separation of the affected barns from the uninfected barns. We may have to sell off a whole barn of pigs, or maybe a barn and a barn next to it. They may either have to be sold off or destroyed, but that's certainly going to be better than losing the whole farm. And we have been able to clean up some farms by early detection and what you might call a surgical removal of the infected animals from the farm as sort of a test and remove. Sometimes it's just too late to save the sows by the time the farm is noted, by the time the problem is noted, but indeed, sometimes we can save everything but just maybe one or two buildings of pigs and get right back into actually never go out of production. It is not necessarily essential that we depopulate the entire herd. However, there are some times that that is the only possible solution, is just to get rid of everything. Whenever we're salvaging the ASF farm, we should consider very seriously how ASF got in. If we don't know how it got in, it's quite likely that it's going to happen again. Usually it's a truck or a feedback involved. Not so often by people. If you have a showering program and changing of clothing, if you're doing the things that you should have been doing already, it probably is a truck or maybe a feedback that brought it in. Dirty boots and dirty clothing, the processing of the feed, the post-processing feed management, these grains dried on the highway, I don't know what to do with those. Restocking the depopulated ASF farm, consider seriously how ASF got into the farm to begin with. Remodel and repair the facilities, upgrade the biosecurity, consider going to some kind of segregated production instead of continuous flow, all in, all out. Any areas of concern? The USDA did some research. They showed you could put pigs back into a room 1 hour after cleaning it up for ASF. Now, if you're going to do some remodeling, it's going to take probably a month or so to get all that stuff done. But there's no reason for the farm to be out of business pigs for 6 months. It's just not necessary. But you need to have good drainage. You need to have a farm that can be cleaned up. If you've got it clean and disinfected, you're ready to go back. The manure pits need to be drained and cleaned. Sometimes that's not possible. It would damage some very valuable equipment. So then you need to do some very, very serious cleaning if you can't remove the slats. Rodent control, defoliate the surroundings, surround the building with rock if possible. Considering that some of these older farms probably ought not go back into the sow business, they could buy their pigs from somebody else. Clean with an alkaline detergent, special attention to the corners, and cleaning of the living quarters. Don't forget anything. Certifying the depopulated farm, we can do some swab tests. You can do a test for enterobacteria and an ASF DNA test. Downtime, how much downtime do you need? I think, you know, if it's clean and dry and you don't need to do any remodeling, you're probably ready to go again. Sentinel pigs, at least 3 weeks. Sentinel pigs, we've done that in some of the herds where we've done partial repopulation. We've used sentinel pigs. We didn't have any problem. Sometimes you might consider finishing a group of pigs on the site before you would make the huge investment of putting back sows. And you might avoid restarting farms where the ticks and pigs, the wild pigs, are a threat. If you can't control the wild pigs, probably don't need to have pigs there. And manure pits, they don't need to worry about those. The virus will eventually die. It's very difficult to remediate them. We did the calculation. It's actually impossible. And it's certainly the virus will eventually die in those manure pits. Just put a little fence around it and tell people not to go there. All in all, it's the way that we do things that causes us trouble. If we can't expect to do things in a wrong way and get good results. And finally, it gets back to the old story that, it's the way that we do things controls our results. If we have a good system, we're going to get good results. If we have a system that's not so good, we may not get the results that we like to see.